Let's talk a little bit about modern franchises. In particular, let's talk about modern franchises in the streaming age. Streaming is a relatively new phenomenon. It only entered the mainstream about 15 years ago, when a mail-order DVD rental company named Netflix came up with the clever idea of allowing members to watch movies and television shows over a newfangled technology called the internet.
Oh, they have the internet on computers now.
In the beginning, streaming offered the promise of a utopian future. Audiences could watch whatever they wanted, whenever they wanted. It got rid of problems like out-of-print home media releases, format drift, or shipping concerns. There really was something for everybody.
The internet?
Damn right. We can pick up all kinds of good crap, not just porno.
Steel, ahead of its time, realizing that even Nazis use the internet. In this new age, children need no longer worry about sending their dad to the video store in search of I Am Legend, only for the title to be out of stock and then have to settle for one of the 27 unrented copies of Rob Schneider's Big Stan.
Do you have anything you could tattoo around my sphincter to make it less attractive?
Initially, Netflix seemed to deliver on this promise. As the only game in town, the service was able to license content from all of the major studios and bring it together under one roof. Being a Netflix customer meant the user had access to a wide range of material. At one point quite recently, Netflix was home to the entire Star Trek franchise and all of modern Doctor Who. We should note, by the way, that this was mutually beneficial. This helped absolutely everybody. Providing audience members with access to these shows allowed them to discover things that they wouldn't find otherwise. It also provided shows like, for example, Breaking Bad and even You, a secondary market in which they could grow their audience. Of course, this system was imperfect. Netflix would be frequently criticized for its lack of older movies. And there was, to be frank, a lot of crap on there. However, it meant that having a Netflix subscription gave the user access to a wide variety of content from a wide variety of sources, and the opportunity to sample new things without any additional risk or cost once the monthly subscription was already paid. The major studios looked at the growth and reach of Netflix and set about launching their own streaming services. This also meant removing their licensed content from Netflix so that it could be siloed by their own in-house services. Of the major studios, Sony is the only one without an in-house streaming service, having figured out that it can win the streaming arms race by selling the weapons. Now, these services arrived quite late, and they lacked the spending power of Silicon Valley company offerings like Amazon Prime or Apple TV Plus, where they were treated as lost leaders or additional subscriptions for gigantic conglomerates. The result of all this was a concentration of intellectual property, where many of these streaming services built their brands around things that audiences already knew and loved. Warner's even briefly toyed with launching a DC-specific streaming service before folding it back into their HBO offering. Disney Plus is built around the pillars of classic Disney, Marvel, Pixar, and Star Wars, to the point that great programming that doesn't fit their brand, including fantastic shows like Only Murders in the Building, Dope Sick, and The Dropout, are farmed out to their subsidiary Hulu within the United States and distributed under the Star brand internationally. Meanwhile, Netflix itself sought to fill the gaps that this left in its streaming library by falling back on the algorithm, using the mountains of customer data that it accumulated over the years to design shows that reminded viewers of the content that the studios had reclaimed. Creative figures like Kerry Joji Fukunaga have talked about how that data is used to shape and mold shows. Fukunaga describes it as a different kind of note-giving. It's not like, let's discuss this and maybe I'm gonna win. The algorithm's argument is gonna win at the end of the day. To be clear, this isn't all bad. Netflix's craven pursuit of awards has led it to commission ambitious and artistic projects like Roma, The Power of the Dog, and the delightful Old Man Slumber Party movie. However, it's worth noting that following a recent stock tumble, the company's first course of action was to cancel a slate of original movies and programming, including work by Academy Award-nominated director and Netflix big stan Ava DuVernay, while announcing a literal real-life Squid Game.
I know writers who use subtext, and they're all cowards.
Along those lines, Apple TV Plus is doing great work building a small but impressive stable of shows that aren't based on popular intellectual properties, like Mythic Quest, For All Mankind, Shining Girls, Severance, and that show where Ned Flanders manages a soccer team. However, by and large, the major streaming services have built their identities around being the home of established and familiar brands, promising their subscribers not just vast libraries of existing content, but also new additions to the larger franchises. This changing marketplace removes a lot of what made those franchises so special in the first place. When franchises like Star Trek or Star Wars launched, they were utterly unlike anything else that had come before. they represented a significant creative and commercial risk for everybody involved.
Risk is our business. That's what the Starship is all about. That's why we're aboard her.
While these earlier franchise installments were riffing on existing pop culture like samurai films and westerns, they were doing so in new and interesting ways. These adventures had to convince people who didn't know what Star Trek or Star Wars were that they were worth their time. Even as these franchises grew in popularity, this understanding remained. These franchises had to constantly prove their worth to new audiences. It's no coincidence, for example, that four of the first five Star Trek spin-offs open with some sort of trial or test for the characters, with the franchise constantly tasked to prove that it was capable of growing and evolving rather than simply repeating what came before. In the age of the algorithm and the streaming service, many of these older franchises find themselves revisiting things that were once new and novel, without understanding what it was that drew audiences to these characters and concepts in the first place. By the end of the first season of Strange New Worlds, there's only one regular cast member who has no ties to existing Star Trek continuity. In a small and telling moment in a show titled Strange New Worlds, the crew have to ask permission to leave the borders of well-explored territory.
Sir, entering non-Federation space requires Starfleet approval.
In the Star Wars franchise, we have spent more time on Tatooine in the past 5 years than in the previous 40. The entire point of the original Star Wars was about Luke wanting to get away from Tatooine, but the franchise keeps coming back. The problem with the algorithm is that it can only point to things that you know you already like, reducing the chance of discovering something new or interesting. There are more severe and unsettling consequences from this reduction of pop art into nothing more than empty iconography to be recycled and repurposed. Most obviously, it divorces these works from their original contexts and meanings. If the Terminator franchise is just a set of familiar imagery that can be reused over and over, the beauty of Cameron's original film is obscured and distorted. George Lucas' Star Wars was the work of an artist in a changing Hollywood landscape, reacting to generational traumas like Watergate and Vietnam by filtering them through an epic space fantasy.
The good guys are the rebels. They're using asymmetric warfare against a highly organized empire. I think we call those guys terrorists today.
When I did it, they were Viet Cong.
Gene Roddenberry and a team of writers including Gene L. Kuhn and Dorothy Fontana extrapolated John F. Kennedy's New Frontier to the end of the decade and beyond.
We stand today on the edge of a new frontier, the frontier of the 1960s, the frontier of unknown opportunities and perils, the frontier of unfilled hopes and unfilled threats.
The final frontier.
The reduction of these properties to familiar tropes and empty repetition has deeper implications. In a way, it's just another example of how things like self-selecting social media bubbles and feed algorithms distort reality to drive engagement no matter the cost. Audiences today seem less curious than they did even a decade ago, less willing to try new things, but also less willing to engage with the original context of things that they already enjoy. Many of the fans most eagerly arguing for a return of these franchises to their roots are those with the least curiosity about those roots. They don't know or care what these things were or the world in which they existed, they just know how these things made them feel. There's a nostalgia for a past that is arguably easier to revisit than ever before via the vast content libraries on these streaming services, but which is instead shorn of any meaning and imprinted on the present. So you end up with a world where fans and franchises are often chasing the ghosts of an imagined past that has been conjured from vague emotional memories, divorced from a reality that many have no interest in actually engaging with.
Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent.
I've been Darren Mooney, and this was In the Frame.